and I don't love asking this question, but it's asked probably the most popular question that's unanswerable. So let me try to ask it in a way that you would actually answer it, which is, of course, you said you don't release shows very often. And the question is, or the requests and the questions is, well, can you tell Dan to do one on the Civil War? Can you tell Dan to do one on Napoleon Bonaparte? Can you tell him to do one, you know, every topic? And you've spoken to this. Actually, your answer about the Civil War is quite interesting.
I didn't know you knew what my answer about the Civil War was.
That you don't, you, as a military historian, you enjoy in particular when there is differences in the armies as opposed
contrasts.
Yeah. As with the Civil War, which like blew my mind when I heard you say it, is, you know, it's, there's not an interesting, a deep, intricate contrast between the two opposing sides.
It's like the Roman Civil Wars, where it's legionary against legionary. Yeah.
And you've also said that you kind of, the shows you work on are ones where you have some roots of fundamental understanding about that period. And so like when you work on a show, it's basically like pulling at those strings further and like refreshing your mind and learning.
You
like
have what definitely is the done the research. Wow. These are like words out of my mouth. Yeah. You're right.
But is there something like shower thoughts on Reddit? Is there some ideas that are like lingering in your head about possible future episodes? Is there things that, whether you not committing to anything, but whether you're going to do it or not, is there something that's like makes you think, that would be interesting to pull at that thread a little bit?
Oh yeah, I we have things we keep in our back pocket for later. So Blueprint for Armageddon, the First World War series we did, that was in my back pocket the whole time. And when the centennial of the war happened, it just seemed to be the likely time to bring out what was...
That was a hell of a series. That's probably one of my favorite series.
My rear end, man, I have to tell you.
Psychologically, you mean?
Well, just, you know, when you get to these, I think it's 26 hours, all pieces together. Think about, and we don't do scripts, it's improvised.
Yeah.
So think about what 20, I had somebody write on Twitter just yesterday saying, he said something like, I'm not seeing the dedication here. You're only getting 2.5 shows out a year. And I wanted to say, man, you have no idea what, the only people who understand really are other history podcasters. Yes. And even they don't generally do 26 hour, yes. You know, that was a 2-year endeavor. As I said, the first show we ever did was like 15 minutes. I could crank out one of those a month. But when you're doing, I mean, the last show we did on the fall of the Roman Republic was 5.5 hours. That's a book, right? And it was part 6 or something. So, I mean, you just do the math.
And it felt like you were, sorry to interrupt, on World War I, it felt like you were emotionally pulled in to it. Like, it felt taxing.
I was going to say, that's a good thing, though, because that, you know, and I think we said during the show, that was the feeling that the people at the time have. And I think at one point we said, if this is starting to seem gruesomely repetitive, now you know how the people at the time felt. So in other words, that had inadvertently, because when you improvise a show, some of these things are inadvertent, but it had inadvertently created the right climate for having a sense of empathy with the storyline. And to me, that those are the serendipitous moments that make this art and not some sort of paint-by-the-numbers kind of endeavor, you know? And that's, to me, that wouldn't have happened had we scripted it out.
So it's mostly, you just bring the tools of knowledge to the table and then in large part improvise, like the actual wording?
I always say we make it like they made things like Spinal Tap and some of those other things where the material, so I do have notes about things like on page 427 of this book, you have this quote, so that I know, aha, I'm at the point where I can drop that in. And sometimes I'll write notes saying, here's where you left off yesterday, so I remember. But in the improvisation, you end up throwing a lot out. And so but it allows us to go off on tangents. Like we'll try things. Like I'll sit there and go, I wonder what this would sound like. And I'll spend 2 days going down that road and then I'll listen to it and go, it doesn't work. But that's, you know, like writers do this all the time. It's called killing your babies, right? You go, can't, you know, get not. Yeah. But people go, so this guy goes, I'm not seeing the dedication. He has no idea how many things we're throwing out. I did an hour and a half. I had an hour and a half into the current show about 2 months ago. And I listened to it and I just went, you know what? It's not right. Boom, out the window. There goes 6 weeks of work,
yeah.
Right? But here's the problem.
Do you trust your judgment on that?
No. No, but here's the thing. Our show is a little different than other people's. Joe Rogan called it evergreen content. In other words, my political show is like a car you buy, and the minute you drive it off the lot, it loses half its value, right? Because it's not current anymore. These shows are just as good or just as bad 5 years from now as they are when we do them. Although the standards on the internet change. So when I listen to my old shows, I cringe sometimes because the standards are so much higher now. Mm. But when you're creating evergreen content, you have two audiences to worry about. You have the audience that's waiting for the next show and they've already heard the other ones and they're impatient and they're telling you on Twitter, where is it? But you have the show's also for people 5 years from now who haven't discovered it yet and who don't care a whit for how long it took because they're going to be able to download the whole and all they care about is quality. And so what I always tell new podcasters is, they always say, I read all these things, it's very important you have a release schedule. Well, it's not more important than putting out a good piece of work. Yeah. And the audience will forgive me if it takes too long, but it's really good when you get it. They will not forgive me if I rush it to get it out on time and it's a piece of crap. So for us, and this is why when you brought up a Spotify deal or anything else, they can't interfere with this at all because my job here, as far as I'm concerned, is quality and everything else goes by the wayside because the only thing people care about long-term, the only thing that gives you longevity is how good is it, right? How good is that book? If you read J.R.R. Tolkien's work tomorrow, you don't care how long it took him to write it. All you care is how good is it today. And that's what we try to think too. And I feel like if it's good, if it's really good, everything else falls into place and takes care of itself.
Although sometimes to push back, sorry to interrupt.
I've done it to you 1,000 times, so you can get me back, please.
Sometimes the deadline, you know, some of the greatest like movies and books have been, you think about like Dostoevsky, I forget which one, Notes from Underground or something. He needed the money, so he had to write it real quick. Sometimes the deadline creates, is powerful at taking a creative mind of an artist and just like slapping it around to force some of the good stuff out. Now, the problem with history, of course, is there's different definitions of good. That like it's not just about what you talk about, which is the storytelling, the richness of the storytelling. And I'm sure you're, you know, again, not to compliment you too much, but you're one of the great storytellers of our time. That I'm sure if you put in a jail cell and forced at a like somebody point a gun at you, you could tell one hell of a good story. But you still need the facts of history. Or not necessarily the facts, but you know, like making sure you painting the right full picture, not perfectly right.
That's what I meant about the audience doesn't understand about a history podcast. Yeah. Where you can't just riff and be wrong. So let me both oppose what you just said and back up what you just said.
Excellent.
So I have a book that I wrote, right? And in a book you have a hard deadline, yes, right? So HarperCollins had a hard deadline on that book. So when I released it, I was mad. Because I would have worked on it a lot longer, which is my style, right? Yeah. Get it right. But we had a chapter in that book entitled Pandemic Prologue, ? And it was the book about the part about the Black Death and the 1918 flu and all that kind of stuff. And I was just doing an interview with a Spanish journalist this morning who said, did you ever think how lucky you got on that, you know, and first of all, lucky on a pandemic, it strikes you. But had I had my druthers, I would have kept that book working in my study for months more. Mm. And the pandemic would have happened.
Yes.
And that episode, and that would have looked like a chapter I wrote after the fact.
Yeah.
I would have had to rewrite the whole thing. It would have been, so that argues for what you said. At the same time, I would have spent months more working on it because to me, it didn't look the way I wanted it to look yet, you know?
Can you drop a hint of the things that you're keeping on the shelves?
The Alexander the Great. I've talked around I talked to somebody Beautiful. The other day. He said, do you know that the very first word in your very first podcast, in the title, the very first thing that anybody ever saw with Hardcore History is the word Alexander? And because the show is entitled Alexander versus Hitler. I have talked around the career. I've done show after. I talked about his mother in one episode. I talked about the funeral games after his death. I've talked around this. I've specifically left this giant Alexandrian-sized hole in the middle because we're going to do that show one day, and I'm going to lovingly enjoy talking about this crazily interesting figure of Alexander the Great. So that's one of the ones that's on the back pocket list. And what we try to do whenever this, we're doing Second World War in Asia and the Pacific now, I'm on part five. Whenever the heck we finish this, the tendency is to then pick a very different period mm-hmm. because we've had it and the audience has had it. So it's time. So I will eventually get to the Alexander saga.
What about just one last kind of little part of this is what about the other half of that first 10-minute, 15-minute episode, which is, so you've done quite a bit about the World War. You've done quite a bit about Germany. Will you ever think about doing Hitler the Man?
It's funny because I talked earlier about how I don't like to go back to the old shows because our standards have changed so much. Well, a long time ago, one of my standards for not getting 5-hour podcasts done or not getting too deeply into them was to flit around the interesting points. We didn't realize we were going to get an audience that wanted the actual history. We thought we could just go with, assume the audience knew the details and just talk about the weird stuff that only makes up one part of the show now. So we did a show called Nazi Tidbits. And it was just little things about, you know, it's totally out of date now. Like, you know, you can still buy them, but they're out of date. Where we dealt a little with it, you know, it would be interesting, but I'll give you another example. I mean, history is not stagnant, as you know. And we had talked about Stalin earlier, and Ghost of the Ostfront was done years ago, and people will write me from Russia now and say, well, your portrayal of Stalin is totally it's outdated because there's all this new stuff from the former Soviet Union. And you turn around and you go, okay, they're right. And so when you talk about Hitler, it's very interesting to think about how I would do a Hitler show today versus how I did one 10 years ago. And you would think, well, what's new? I mean, it happened so long, but there's lots of new stuff and there's lots of new scholarship. And so I would think that would be an interesting one to do someday. I haven't thought about that. That's not in the back pocket, but that'd be interesting.
I have a disproportionate amount of power because I trapped you somehow in a room and thereby
during a pandemic.
So like my hope will be stuck in your head, but after Alexander the Great, which would be an amazing podcast, I hope you do give a return to Hitler. The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich, which to me, it's a
contemporary book, basically.
Yeah. And it's by a person who was there.
Shirer, yeah.
I really loved that study of the man of Hitler, and I would love to hear your study of certain aspects of it. Perhaps even an episode that's like more focused on a very particular period. I just feel like you can tell a story that, it's funny, Hitler is one of the most studied people, and I still feel like most of the stories haven't been told.
Oh, and I've got 3 books at home. I'm on all the publishers' lists now, and they just, there's young Hitler, there's this Hitler, there's that. I mean, I've been reading these books, and I've read about Hitler. I read The Rise and Fall of the Third Reich. My mother thought I needed to go to a psychologist because I read it when I was 6. And she said, there's something wrong with the boy. But she was right. But she was absolutely right. But you would think that something like that is pretty established fact. And yet there's new stuff coming out all the time. And needless to say, Germany's been investigating this guy forever. And sometimes it takes years to get the translations. I took 5 years of German in school. I can't read any of it. So he is, when you talk about fascinating figures, the whole thing is so twistedly weird. It came out a couple years ago. Somebody found a tape of him talking to I want to say it was General, the Finnish General Mannerheim, right? And he's just in a very normal conversation of the sort we're having now. And, you know, the Hitler tapes, when you hear him normally, he's ranting and raving. But this was a very sedate, and I wish I'd understood the German well enough to really get a feel, because I was reading what Germans said, and they said, wow, you can really hear the Southern accent, you know, little things that only a native speaker would hear. And I remember thinking, this is such a different side of this twisted character. And you would think that this was information that was out in the Rise and Fall of the Third Reich era, but it wasn't. Mm-hmm. And so this goes along with that stuff about new stuff coming out all the time. Alexander, new stuff coming out all the time.
Really?
Well, at least interpretations rather than factual data.
And those color those give depth to your understanding.
Yes, you want that because I mean, the historiography, people love that. And that was a byproduct of my lack of credentials, where we thought we're going to bring in The historians, we call them audio footnotes, right? A way for me to say, listen, I'm not a historian, but I'll quote this guy who is, so you can trust him. But then we would quote other people who had different views, and people didn't realize that you know, if they're not history majors, that historians don't always agree on this stuff and that they have disagreements, and they loved that. So I love the fact that there's more stuff out there because it allows us to then bring in other points of view and sort of maybe three-dimensionalize or flesh out the story a little bit more.